Very warm welcome to A Dialogue Through Material. My name is Jana Mutu and I'm the curator of live programs here at Nottingham Contemporary. We hope all of you and your families are well and healthy in these complicated, unbracketed times. For those of you who have been with us previously at Nottingham Contemporary, welcome back. And for those who are here for the first time in the building, thank you for joining our community and today's event. It's a pleasure to host a nice conversation, a dialogue through material between our exhibiting artists, Céline Condorelli and Hannah Catherine Jones. You can see the manifestation of their work in Gallery 2 if you haven't seen. The exhibition is on for another week, so do visit us again soon. Our live programs open up different interventions and propositions within our curatorial research across the organization. And this event expands on our current exhibition, Our Silver City, but it also connects with our multi-platform research program, Emergency and Emergence, which unearths transdisciplinary, sensorial, and speculative practices of radical sense-making and wayfinding via questions of repair, pedagogy, remediation, and mutation. This evening, Céline Condorelli and Hannah Catherine Jones will discuss their collaboration and practice by sharing visual, aural, and literary references that have influenced their works in the exhibition, Our Silver City. By bringing together unlikely materials, they will create an active archive juxtaposed with one another to trace what residues may leave behind. Some very brief housekeeping notes before I introduce our guests. Our live programs of talks, performances, and screenings seek to create challenging environments where open-mindedness and respect for each other's approaches and perspectives can foster growth. So please be mindful and respectful of each other's opinions and views. I would like to use this opportunity to extend our thanks to our founders, the University of Nottingham and Nottingham Trent University, for generously and graciously supporting today's event, as well as my colleagues, Helen Hamilton, Jim Brower, Shannon Charlesworth, Tom Chamberlain, and so many for making this event possible. Lastly, as with all events here at Nottingham Contemporary, today's talk is free to attend, but all donations are greatly appreciated to help support future free programs. So without further delay, I'm very pleased to introduce our speakers, Céline Condorelli, is a London and Lisbon-based artist and was one of the founding directors of Eastside Projects Birmingham. She's the author and editor of Sport Structures, published by Sternberg Press in 2009. Condorelli combines a number of approaches from developing structures for sporting to broader inquiries into forms of commonality and discursive sites. Hannah Catherine Jones, a.k.a. Foxy Moran, is a London-based artist, scholar, multi-instrumentalist, radio presenter, and DJ. For those who haven't listened yet, she has a brilliant show on NTS titled The Opera Show, so please do check it out. She's a composer and conductor and founder of Peckham Chamber Orchestra, a community project established in 2013. Jones is currently an AHRC scholar at Oxford University, for which the ongoing body of work, The Odes, will be presented as a series of live and recorded audiovisual episode compositions using disrupted sound as a methodology of institutional decolonization, and she'll be sharing that with us today as well. I'm going to hand it over to our guest who will speak for an hour, and then we will open up to questions and reflections from you. The floor is yours, Céline and Hannah. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, the first thing to say is that the reason there was a track playing just before Janan introduced us, thank you so much, it's not a random track. It comes from a playlist that Hannah had made for an arts institution called Wising Art Center. Before I met Hannah, I encountered her work. And that was one of the things that I was listening to when I was thinking through the project, looking for somebody to commission to make a soundtrack for an exhibition. To make a soundtrack for the exhibition that is upstairs, except that at the time I really had no idea what it was going to look like. And specifically within, I think it's a 45-minute long playlist.
It's an hour.
Yeah. That track, which is, I didn't know what it was, but it's called Time Lapse, just did something to me. It still does, actually. I think it's an incredibly glorious track in many ways, and it just stayed with me. So that track is one of the reasons why I looked for you.
Mm. And yeah, I was really pleased when you invited me to kind of contribute to the second, it's Gallery 2, right, where the show is?
Gallery 2.
And to sort of respond to the way that you framed the show and your installation, because you are essentially like an artist and curator of that space. And I remember the way that you approached me was kind of like, I need to give the room like a soul. I need to find some sort of sonic way of bringing everything together. So I sort of approached it as a composer, as someone, you know, that word composer means someone that puts things together, but it's like brings together sounds and tries to sort of like get a sense for what the energy of that space needs to be. Yeah, and it's funny because the Michael Nyman track, The Time Lapse, it's a soundtrack to a film by Peter Greenaway called A Zed and Two Noughts. So yeah, it's cinematic. It's something that I use as part of a wider playlist. You can see all my notes, I realise. I'm like, oh, lots of bits about Sun Ra. But anyway, I'm just sharing my screen. My screen is full of things that may or may not be relevant, but, you know, feast your eyes. But the initial kind of material was the way that you were looking at octopuses. And that was the kind of inspiration for how I was trying to think about colour and texture in sound. But maybe you want to kind of show a bit of that.
Yes, the initial invitation was very much centred around this ongoing research that I have. I've been working with colour separation and colour printing and colour, you know, in print, for quite a long time. And there's a certain dead-endness to how prints are produced. You're all familiar with the CMYK process to create the illusion of color. Now, the recent research into what printing might look like in the future is not to create the illusion of color, but looks at animals like cephalopods and specifically octopus in terms of creating skins that are capable of producing a color effect, so that the color in that sense is not, you know, it's not something that looks like color, but it is a state. I mean, what I mean by that is, I think, really incredibly well illustrated by this YouTube clip, which doesn't have any sound, made by a diver. So that's not a digital animation. That's actually an animal that you can't see until you see it, until the animal sees the camera, basically, and realizes that they need to escape. And then just at the end, it come back and it just splurts a little bit of ink, right? Which is, of course, a defense mechanism, but that's how humans have developed printing, is through ink. So the relationship between color printing and an animal that hasn't changed very much in 16 million years and yet still holds the key to what we may be able to do in the future is, to me, quite extraordinary. And I think I showed you this clip, actually.
Yeah. Can we have the rest of it playing while we chat? Just because it is an incredible clip. and it's not got an exam.
Yeah, but then I think it's this guy wrote
I remember now, because, yeah, it's just that beginning bit that shows, yeah, this thing, this kind of, I guess, what we would call a phenomenon. But when we had our first conversation about it, you were telling me all this other stuff about it, about how that happens and how it's not only colour, but it's texture. So it's like the octopus changes the texture of its skin to as part of the camouflage. So if it's on like a rough sort of knobbly surface, its skin will imitate that. So it made me think of
topographical maps.
Thank you. Where you have the layers and, you know, there's something about that that's just extraordinary. So as someone who's working with sound and was thinking through, you know, how do I go about putting myself in a position to connect with this show, you know, our Silver City 2094, this futuristic, thinking of the future through, you know, what is the world going to be like in that year? What are the kind of, like, memories are we going to have of the kinds of sounds? And how do I sort of use this incredible creature as a way to explore texture? And what I mean by that is, like, as a multi-instrumentalist, I'll be listening to how one tone sounds. The instruments I use in the soundtrack are synthesizers. So this idea of synthesis and sort of, you know, being made up of many things or being able to kind of signify many things was super important. And, oh, this one's so beautiful, the way this is a close-up, right, of the actual cells.
So that's the close-up of the skin. There's a film upstairs by Anna Barham that also films the skin of a cephalopod asleep. And, I mean, for anybody, you know, to go back to image making, for anybody who's ever done any printing, this is very much what the half-toning process is in silk screening. If you zoom in on a newspaper, that's what you see. You see dots of color. And there's something so bizarre about this similarity, because, of course, this is like an abstract composition. That, you know, I see it as an abstract composition, but it's actually the skin of this extraordinary animal. It also dreams. The octopus is able to dream through its skin because it's got a dispersed nervous system. So it's, you know, many people describe this animal as the most alien that one could imagine because it's extraordinarily intelligent, probably as intelligent as humans, if not more, but at the opposite end of the spectrum in terms of how it functions. So the octopus doesn't have a brain and a body. Its entire skin is part of the nervous system, so it's like a dispersed skin. So it is literally able to think through its skin.
I've just popped this up because that's what's come to my mind, because I've been researching into cymatics, and I watched this documentary the other day. Hans Jenny, he's a Swiss, he's from Switzerland.
I know, exactly.
This video, it kind of shows what happens to different materials when different pitches encounter them. So how sound itself can radically change if you use sand or if you use water, and you alter one pitch. So you might have like a, it might shift up, and the patterns will be completely different based on the, you know, frequency, the number of vibrations per second, that's essentially what sound is. So in terms of thinking about how I put the soundscape together, I was absolutely thinking about slow changing pitches, maybe in between one or two notes, like, and the motifs that I ended up using, it was sequential. I think there were bigger steps than that, like, and this descending sort of feeling as, you know, the octopus goes underwater, as this kind of sense of despair, this sort of going, feeling quite down, thinking about this year, 2094, and us as humans, and I'm kind of like properly, you know, going all over the place. But that's kind of what this commission collaboration did to me. It asked me to think about what it is I do think will be left, or what it is that I would maybe like to be remembered, and that's a combination of things. So thinking about the synthesis of pitch itself through the instruments, you know, I used a microcorg, lots of bass, a subwoofer. I wanted it to kind of make an impression on the body, you know? I want you to be able to feel the bass. But I also, I'm thinking maybe it's time to play a piece, maybe in the background, that sort of inspired how I got there. Because thinking of, you know, this future and looking back from the future, or thinking of ourselves as being studied, you know, maybe. And the title of the work, I called it In Memoriam, which I spelled incorrectly a number of times. And I realised as I was making it that I was sort of dialoguing with, or semi sort of sampling, quoting a piece written by Arvo Pärt that I've done with the orchestra. I've conducted it. And I'll just play a bit of it and then maybe talk a bit more.
Happens, nature has evolved an eye, almost like ours, but in reverse. The right side out eye belongs to certain cephalopods, including octopuses, squids, and their ilk. It is a single lens structure with an iris, a lens, and a retina, just like the human eye, and light enters the eyeball and is projected against the retina, just as in the human eye. The cephalopod eyes even develop in a similar way to the vertebrates, albeit with one crucial exception. No folding back and forth occurs. So the part of the system that becomes the optic nerve remain sensibly on the outside, and their equivalent to our photoreceptors ends up on the inside with no extra layers to buffer incoming light. Current research indicates that octopuses are colorblind. though they see and distinguish complex information, including shapes, brightness, and spatial orientation, just as humans do. Unlike humans, they can also perceive the planes of polarization of light. This may indicate that the octopus has the ability to communicate with its own kind by manipulating the polarization of light reflected off its skin, meanwhile evading detection or at least decoding by other animals, including us. In the brains of higher organisms like octopuses and humans, Jung emphasized that the determining factor in specific memory formation is not the requisite quantity of chemicals, but the patterns of connectivity. The new behavior is likely to be the result of new connections, and new connections will be made in response to the unexpected environmental stimulus that interrupts familiar patterns, the non sequitur. Through its ongoing process of remembering and learning, brains are physically modified by directly adapting to changes in their physical environment. The context makes the subject. Octopus behaviors are categorized as displays and anti-displays. A display is a pattern consisting of some combination of movement, posture, color, and texture change. Displays may be either ritualized or unritualized. Unritualized displays are numerous and frequent, in which information is incidentally encoded. Ritualized displays are relatively infrequent, in which information is deliberately encoded. Every display communicates information, but ritualized displays have been adapted by the octopus specifically to communicate something.
That's, yeah, so amazing. And I have read that before, because that's a kind of like remix of a lot of your bits that you've read, research that you've found, and then also like your take or what you've kind of seen as being important to this, to use that word, methodology of the octopus for this, I want to say show, installation, but creative practice, let's say, because it is broader than what's in the show, right? And what really stands out to me in relation to like music about that is this ritual and unritual, or ritualized and unritualized, in terms of thinking about how I encountered this piece, this music in the background, and how you could say that the weeks and weeks of rehearsals of preparing it is like the unritualized, and then the live performance of it is the ritual. So it's almost like I can't help but think of that just based on the fact that, you know, I'm going through stuff with the orchestra right now. We're rehearsing for a concert and reflecting on how this piece, it's like I absorbed it and it came out when I was trying to make the music for this soundtrack. And not in it, like I listened back to it and I was like, I'm doing like a descending motif that seems to keep getting longer and longer and more expansive and more expansive. Because Arvo Pärt wrote that piece of music, the last note is just, you're just there at the bottom, everyone's doing the same note, and you've kind of arrived at a place together. And the last thing you hear is the bell, the chime of the bell, sort of ringing on there. And to kind of take it back to what I actually made, it seemed super important thinking of this city, Nottingham, and, you know, what are the sounds of this city that would kind of make sense in the context of thinking about a future? And of course, the bell, the church bell, St. Mary's Church, and the bell as having this, I guess it signifies like death. You kind of hear it a lot in film soundtracks where it's kind of like, you know, the knell, and it'll ring on. It does that kind of thing. Yeah, and I guess this is a very sort of a meandering way of just trying to acknowledge how much that piece, getting inside that piece, affected me as a musician, and how like I said, I noticed it emerged in the way that I'd made this piece. How do we remember something, you know? In memoriam, it's a lament, and it's something that forces you to kind of like go deeper, kind of to think about things, to reflect on things, and to think about you know, the rate that we're going, like, this is worthy of a lament, you know? Yeah, and also just taking a moment to appreciate how well the music seemed to go with this cymatics documentary, which is just like, yes.
So two notes to that. Mm-hmm. The book that we're pointing out is the novella written by Liz Jensen. I hope you may have seen it upstairs. Liz Jensen was one of the four commissioned artists to develop ideas for the show. And as we workshopped over a period of 2 years to try and think what the city that we're in, Nottingham, might be like in 2094, what the future might be, this pervasive idea of ecological breakdown was perhaps the most present and the thing we could not get rid of. You know, it was impossible to think about the future outside ecological breakdown. That was the dominating idea in all of the conversations that we had. And it is, I think, you know, not just true of us as a group of people, it is just the thing that one sees in the future. The other note, which is completely unrelated, about the church bell, which you've just reminded me of a story that I studied because I was looking at the history of the separation between animate and inanimate objects, which is not such an obvious story, actually. You know, for example, there's now lawyers trying to give rights to forests or rivers. You know, so this idea of who is able to speak for themselves, which is the traditional distinction with legal subjects, is not necessarily that obvious. But there was a bell that was in Russia, in a town called Uglich, a bell that what rang the signal of insurrection instead of the signal of mourning during the death of the son of Ivan the Terrible. This is in the 17th century, I think. And the bell was sentenced to permanent exile as well as the person who rang it. So the object was guilty. You know, it was not actually uncommon in common law in Britain until the 18th century to condemn the person who had committed a crime as well as the object of the crime. So a knife that was used to murder somebody would also be thrown away or destroyed or cast at sea. Anyway, this bell was condemned to permanent exile and was sent to some field in Siberia where it remained for 80 years, and it had to be officially pardoned by a priest in order to come back to the church where it now hangs in Uglich. And this whole thing took somehow almost a century. So the idea of one, objects being guilty or at least complicit, and definitely sentient and responsible, and also the bell containing this capacity for communication is somehow there in the story.
That's fascinating. That is so fascinating. And it reminds me of something that a student of mine, I always feel a bit weird about that thing, because I learned so much from her, but she was telling me about, oh my God, I can't remember any of the words that I need to remember to tell this story properly, so I'll just kind of try my best. But a coastal town somewhere really down south, and she went and did a recording of these bells, and these bells were used almost like a sonic lighthouse. So they were used to kind of warn of approaching ships, because you could hear the bells from sea, but if you knew what you were listening for. So it was kind of used as like an aural sort of signal. I'm going to kind of leave that there ringing in the air, as it were, because I can't tell the story fully. But that is so fascinating. And they do have this, I don't know how to describe it. They are this kind of, they're circular, they're dome-like, they kind of contain but kind of push out sound. And they are a way of communicating often a passage of time, but also like to tell you that there is a place of ritual communion, like where the bell is, you know what I mean? You go to the church to gather, often to sing. So for me it was like, yes, the bell does have this is it stereotypical, or like, it doesn't have to be stereotypical in a bad way, but it signifies death in a kind of composerly way, but it also signifies the places where we come together. But that story is wild, absolutely wild, and I can't quite assemble my thoughts on what I feel about the bell? Do I feel sorry for it? Do I think it should have been punished? Did the bell feel anything?
I forgot an element to the story. Mm-hmm. It was pardoned, but its tongue was taken out so that it would never ring again. And this is the church of this main town, Uglik, which I've never been to. But you, when you see photographs today of the church, you see this bell with the tongue taken out. So it is mute.
Wow. I mean, wow. Let's take a moment for the bell. That's a lot. That's fascinating. I mean, let me try and... I mean, that's one element.
Talk about now.
I know, we could talk about the bell for hours. Poor bell. In terms of trying to think of, elements to the soundscape, the bell was important, synthesizers were important. It was really fascinating encountering the show and seeing some of the objects that were there, including like a kind of concrete kind of radio-esque, it certainly has an antennae on it. And I was like, yes, because one of the synthesizers I use, the theremin, is essentially a failed radio. That's how it was invented. It has an antennae. It has another antennae there. And it works with proximity to this antennae to create pitch. So it is it's a transmitter. Mm. And it's something that you are searching for sound with, as in you're like, well, got no notes to press. So it has that quality to it. But it also, you know, it's ironic because it does communicate, but not in a radio way where it gives you information. It communicates through this eerie timbre that you're like, it's uncanny, because you're a bit like, is it a human voice or is it, what is it? And I think using that, it's very overused in a science fiction kind of way, but the way I use it, I tend to use it more in like a lamenting sort of way, or with the voice, which kind of like, sort of subverts it. I'm playing with that uncanniness of the digital and the human, much like our mates, the octopus. This thing of like, when should I put a filter on my voice in song so it very gradually shifts timbre like the octopus does, but in a way that's, you know, sort of how you feel rather than what you see. It's still like about perception, even if it's not like, the octopus is doing it to, well, it is a form of communication.
Totally.
Yeah, I'm not going to try and like lock it down to totally. That and is that and that is that. But maybe I should play something that's really important, maybe not the whole thing, but something to do with the voice. Is that appropriate? Or like, do you want to... I'm trying to just...
Mintanaka or the voice? That's what we've got.
I reckon the voice and then, if that's all right. Because just thinking about... in relation to the bell and the synthesizers, I really did want to have something human in there. And I was thinking specifically of Leontine Price. And to give you a bit of context, this was her last performance at the New York Met. It was in 1985. And the track that she's singing is called O Patria Mia, which means, oh, my dear homeland. And then I think it's got the lyrics there. But I was thinking a lot about this as in... The levels in this... Sorry?
It's Fatherland, actually.
Is it?
Unfortunately. I'm sorry.
Well, I've flipped it to Motherland. You know, patriarchy's always lurking, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I'll play a little bit of this, and then we'll just keep chatting.
Thank you.
it's a shame to not have that whole thing. I will say that it had 25 minutes of applause and a standing ovation. Can you imagine? But it was her last performance as an opera singer, and the fact that she was playing, you know, Nubian Aida, first black opera singer on the stage at the Met, black female opera singer on the stage, and that performance with its layers, and it was live streamed in 1985, so it was like cutting edge technology, the way that she sings, the glissando, that's the kind of like, I guess the energy that I guess we were talking about earlier, and how to kind of like, well, you were saying it, so I kind of don't want to step on what the energy that you were saying about what you wanted to create, which...
Yes, which I was trying to describe why this is connected to making exhibitions, you know, like what is it that makes sense to me in a way? Why did I call you, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think what you're referring to is this idea that I always... think that I'm not exhibiting anything. I'm trying to expose you, an audience, or myself, to an experience, and a really precise, or as precise as possible, aesthetic experience. So I think part of the point of working with exhibition making is, you know, also in the way that I do, which means I mix lots of those works by lots of people. I think through many different types of material, and I think with people, I don't think alone, is to try and create an aesthetic experience so that it inverses the sort of object-subject ideas that are normally, you walk into a room and you see a thing on display that is just contained, and you just walk off to the next thing. So that, I think, is... You know, sometimes I manage, sometimes I don't. It's quite difficult to do, obviously. Part of it is an interest in the audience, you know, and not thinking of the audience as actually passive, but as making meaning by walking through from thing to thing and creating effectively culture, and in that sense also the culture of the future. But there are these rare moments when something that you see or something that you're exposed to just pierces through and really touches you, because normally culture is this thing that, you know, is supposed to touch you. You can't touch it in general. But it's rare that the feeling is mutual, right? That it's reciprocal, that you just get something that goes straight in, and it's not exactly discursive, it's not exactly just through your brain. And it happened with me through your work, definitely. And that was the question, whether it's possible to construct it within an exhibition experience as well. It's happened to me a few other times, including through this performance that I saw at Tate. Maybe that's a good time to talk about it. So in 2018, I saw Min Tanaka perform at Tate. He was performing inside an installation of a sort of steam fog by an artist whose name I've now forgotten, but will come back to me. And I found it, well, I'll just show you, it's a very short clip. Oops, sorry. So, I mean, this is an incredible convergence of minds, right? There's Yushi Sakamoto, there's Fujiko Nakaya, and Min Tanaka. I found this performance absolutely incredible, and I was thinking, you know, the moments when you go somewhere, you make the effort of going somewhere, and it just changes everything. It makes your day, makes your week, makes your month. But I was thinking, Min Tanaka, like, I know this name. Why would I know this person? And it took me ages to realize that it was the same person who had performed in a, you know, I know about it because I know this little piece of footage. I don't know how famous it actually is, but there was a performance of buto dance, so a traditional Japanese, you know, even operatic dance, in a clinic for psychotic patients in the 80s that was run by a philosopher. He was a clinician and a philosopher called Guattari. So it's the same guy. When he performed at Tate, he must have been, this is 2018, he must have been in his late 80s. Because you also see him here. Performing at La Borde in France, this clinic founded by Félix Guattari, in which the patients were free to roam, and there was no treatment as such, but there was an incredibly rich cultural life. And Min Tanaka was there for some months, but this was the piece of footage that I knew.
Yeah, I'm just like, yeah, it's funny because we both seem to have turned to like the 80s and like these moments of like, and also the operatic, because the dancer is Min Tanaka, yeah. So he chose that piece of music to be the soundtrack for that footage, right? Yeah.
No, it was playing. It was playing outside.
So
he danced to it.
So was somebody singing?
I mean,
that
I know
live?
This from secondhand accounts, obviously, yeah, no, because no. That's how it is in history books. But
got you. I'm just trying to understand as to whether there was a live opera singer or it was playing on a record.
It was recording.
It sounds like it's playing on a record. Because for me, it's like I can't like look at that and not take in all the elements, like the birds singing, the fact that it's operatic. It kind of comes down to because that footage is very, very affecting. It just is. There's a look of ecstasy on his face. There's, you know, the wider context of them being in a psychiatric kind of, you know, asylum or, you know, institution. There's a lot going on. And I think that, I wonder what it would be like with a different soundtrack to it. I know that, yeah, this is kind of, you can't separate out that performance from that piece of music that's been played at all. Well, you can mute it and put something else, but I mean in terms of like how we're talking and thinking about it. And I guess like, yeah, it makes me think a lot of just how important the voice is, the human voice in song. And again, I know we're anchored into opera, which is, you know, my one of my areas of specialty and interest, and also in a big way trying to sort of shake up what that is and think about it in terms of vocal labor rather than this Western the pinnacle, like the crown jewels of like culture, but at the same time it sort of does do that, and it comes back to the very vibrations, the oscillations, and how they hit us on a physiological level, how similar opera is to, you know, it's the voice in an extreme of emotion. So that makes us think of crying, of screaming, of pleasure, of pain. So it's always gonna kind of like tip you. And in fact, it reminds me of, I often mention something another French person, Lacan, said about the infant's cry. Like you might struggle with my pronunciation here. So the infant's cry is described as,
sorry, that was really loud.
Was that the tension? That was the tension of the upcoming terrible pronunciation. So Lacan describes the infant's cry as un cri pur, P-U-R, the pure cry.
A pure cry.
Yeah, and un cri pour, P-O-U-R. Four. Can you pronounce those two things?
Hang on. What's the second one?
So I'm going to write it down and you're going to pronounce it.
The first one is pur.
Yeah. Un cri pur. And the other one's P-O-U-R.
Un cri pur.
So say them both again.
Un cri pur et un cri pur.
Yeah.
I mean, it takes quite a bit of living in France to know the difference between those two. But the difference is between a pure cry and a cry for, crying for something.
And that's really important, because when the infant comes out, it's crying because it's pure, it's just been born, it's got breath in its lungs, it's like, ah! And then it's also a cry for the mother, it understands that becomes the language, I cry and I get something. So I read that and it proper stuck with me, because I love puns, and because I'm fascinated by the voice, and when we sing, we can sing because it's just so important to kind of have that release and that intensity, but it's also to communicate with people and to affect them. And I think that's why opera seems to like, you know, we can't seem to get away from it. I do have a specific interest in it. I do try and destabilize it and decolonize it, but at the same time, we have both arrived at these like moments that include, you know, This energy that we would like to at least incorporate into how we make art or make the artistic experience. That's kind of how I'm sort of, thinking about the dialogue between these materials that we've arrived at. But,
Should we open for questions?
Yeah, maybe so.
Does anybody have any questions or comments?
Hiya.
Is it because you're a musician that you decided to think about the bells that were sounding out to sea rather than a foghorn?
Ooh, that's a good question. I mean, a foghorn has a completely different kind of effect. The reason that I was thinking about bells is because we're in the city of Nottingham and the church is right there. Had we been on a coastal town and, you know, that would have been part of the soundscape potentially, I'm not sure. I guess I was trying to just incorporate sounds that I knew were of this city. And like I said, it has this like sort of signification of death and communion, and I guess I just wanted to like anchor on that. But there are sirens in the work, and I guess in a way I was thinking about emergency, as in, you know, emergency vehicles, but also like these mythical creatures that we call sirens that sing. So I was trying to like pun on that. And a foghorn and a siren, you know, it's a sound that comes from a vehicle, so we could do a foghorn remix.
Following on from that, as you are a trained musician, when you are composing these pieces of music as soundscapes, are you still following the normal things that musicians do and keeping within certain chordal limits?
That's a good question. I guess in the work that I produced for this, the Portal in Memoriam, it's called the soundtrack, or the sound work, I don't know what you want to call it, a composition. It is quite tonal. There's jarring elements to it because of the way that I've sort of used samples of things like keyboards and static and modems. I couldn't necessarily tell you what key it's in, but I'm pretty sure it's in a melodic minor mode. So almost like, you know, Gregorian chant monks of back in the day. It's not in it's certainly not in a major key. It's in a minor key. Or can I even say that? Yes, that's the word I was looking for. Thank you. It's definitely an intuitive sort of like, the way I made it was like entering into the energy of all the things that I thought gave me a sense of what I wanted to produce for this. And it was produced kind of like a performance, but in my little home studio. And then I worked with and it was 48 minutes of sounds I'd made and the energy that I had. And then I just kind of post-produced it to make what's in the gallery there. But yeah, it was intuitive. Yeah.
You talked about vocal labour. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm a singer myself as well. And you talked about destabling something and decolonising. I want to hear what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Sounds like there's something that needs to be expressed, and I'd like to hear that.
Sure. So I see all types of singing, like whether you're trained as an opera singer, which I've been lucky enough to have done that, or whether you are, you know, Mariah Carey, or whether you are an untrained voice who's singing in your local community choir, indigenous kind of practices that would just use voice as part of it without even thinking categorizing what we would call, you know, this is a genre, this is jazz singing, this is opera, this is that. So what I try and do through the radio show that I've been doing for years, it's called The Opera Show. So it has a certain set of expectations around what kind of music I would be playing, of which Leontine Price singing in this style would be like expected. And I do play kind of what we would traditionally understand as opera for a lot of the reasons that, yeah, we were getting onto towards the end. But ultimately, I do have a kind of wider mission to destabilize what we would consider to be opera, or what we would consider to be like, it's almost like trying to destabilize the idea of high art and low art, and just be like, let's just equalize it to be like, all forms of vocal labor have value and affect depending on the context, and we shouldn't just privilege one over the other. Yeah, that's what I was trying to say.
So do you mean it's destabilizing what opera is, or destabilizing the idea of hierarchies of vocals?
Hopefully both.
Is opera a style, or what?
That's a good question. I mean, how much vibrato is there? These are the things that I wonder how,
okay.
The questions we might ask of how to do that. But it's a massive topic, and I'm glad a singer's kind of like probing me on it. But it is, it's really fascinating. So many people say, oh, I can't sing. It's like...
Everyone can sing.
Thank you.
I know that.
Yes. So it's kind of ironic because I'm privileging the thing that I am trying to destabilize, but ultimately, like, there is an essence of it that won't leave me, won't leave us alone.
It's that finding of the voice, though, isn't it? And understanding that's who you are. You're not Mariah or you're not Madonna. You've got your own thing.
Yeah.
Let's find that within you.
Exactly
and
that.
That's what it is. For me, isn't it?
That's such a great point. Thank you for that.
But part of the work, I mean, from my side, the understanding of destabilizing something like opera also, I think, points to opera. It's not just an experience, it's also funding system, hierarchies of what is valuable music as opposed to not valuable music, sets of rules as to who is able to go. I mean, I've never been able to face the price that an opera ticket costs to go to the National Opera. In London, I've lived there for 30 years, I've never been. But I know that the Opera House in London gets more funding than all of the contemporary art institutions together, right? So, you know, the capacity to understand how much funding goes towards, in a way, you know, continuing a genre that has been going for so long, and the work of people who have been dead for many, many years, when there's no funding for you, you know, at some point, there's also, you know, those questions also come. It's quite hard not to look at it like that as well. So, for me, destabilizing opera and destabilizing these kinds of genres of high culture also comes with the practicalities of how people actually are able to continue working and producing culture.
That's super important. And, you know,
I'm just thinking about opera and classical music. I love all music, but there is something potentially about it being in another language. I don't know if it's sung in Latin or Italian.
Italian.
And there's something about that is beautiful and romantic. And with that comes potential status and the people that potentially enter to go and see that. I can't imagine not going to see opera sung in English and it potentially having the same effect. I might be ignorant, I don't know. But there's something about hearing it in another language which just makes me go, ooh, beautiful.
I think for me, that's a really interesting point again. It's like, so when you... It's like the voice in song is different to the voice in speech, because when you're hearing someone talk, you can't really hear, like, the timbre of the voice because the meaning gets in the way. Do you know what I mean? So if I was just kind of going, you could hear a lot more of, like, maybe my voice sounds more mellow or, what do they call that? A glottal start like that.
Guttural.
Guttural. Mm-hmm. You'd be able to tell all these kinds of things that you wouldn't be able to hear because of the words. And then when you add pitch into that, everything changes, and breath and vibrations and all that stuff. And then when you've got, you know, a language that you can't speak, like Italian or Latin or whatever, then you're more able to focus on it as this instrument rather than what it's actually saying. So it is like, you know.
When I was looking at the opera fragment, I was actually thinking something along those lines that, I mean, I speak Italian, I'm Italian, I can't understand it.
Molto bene. Sorry.
I cannot understand it, but it also reminded me of how, like many people who don't have English as a first language, I grew up with music I did not understand. I grew up with all the songs that everybody in the world grows up with, in English, a lot of them, as music. You just don't understand them. It's only later, after a few years of living here, because it's not that easy to understand the singing voice, right? After a few years of living here, then I was like, at some point, little by little, I would be able to listen to the songs. I was like, oh, that's what they're saying. Mm-hmm. You know, understanding how some things are totally despicable. For example, there are in songs that you've loved since you were a teenager or something like this. But that relationship is really funny, you know? Because for native English speakers, it's always hilarious how foreigners would know songs without knowing any of the meaning and might even know them by heart, you know, be able to sing them.
Having learned them phonetically.
Having learned them phonetically, yeah. Of course. But in a way, it's not that dissimilar to the experience of listening to opera, of course, because, mm-hmm. okay, it's in Italian. If you don't have a libretto, no Italian speaker will actually understand. They might get some words, but you don't actually understand it. So the libretto is key in terms of meaning, but it's not the same experience as the experience of listening.
100%. But at the same time, you know she's not singing about something that's joyful.
Yeah, you get something. Yeah, you get meaning, yeah. But you don't get words.
Yeah. No, it is really interesting.
You get meaning, the meaning that goes through exactly. That other meaning.
It's so sort of, yeah, layered. And yeah, we've kind of moved away from the... Oh. And then we've got another question here after that as well. Yeah, just to, yeah.
Maybe... There's different. I think there's different levels of listening as well, because I think sometimes, like, we all know a song, but we don't know the words, but we know it, and there's something about the feeling of it, and we could be listening to that song for years and get to 2025 and then go, oh, that really resonates with me, or what the hell am I singing?
Yeah. It reminds me of that video of the, oh, my God, is this even relevant?
I think there was a question here.
I'll hold that for after. I will chat to you after. Yeah, we've got another question. Don't apologise at all. Thanks for your contributions.
Yes, I'm Italian too, and I agree on what you said. It's not about the language. I'm Italian, and I find it quite difficult sometimes to understand. I love opera, but I find it very difficult to understand all the words.
Yeah.
I can understand probably the meaning of what they're saying, but yeah, so it's not about the language. Yeah, I agree with you 100%. Yeah, and also you were saying about the Royal Opera House in London. When I used to live in London, there were some like promotions online to go and get cheaper tickets. Whereas in Italy now they do like a discount in Milan for La Scala every Sunday to attract people to go and see the opera. I think it would be a good idea to do that in England too, you know, to attract more audience for opera, because, you know, we can lose opera through the years, maybe, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of like, oh my God, we've ended up talking so much about opera, but I guess that's what happens when we both played something that incorporated the operatic as a... Yes. And that's the thing towards it as well, because when I think about making art or making a kind of artistic experience, the kind of, it still does loom over there, this kind of, because opera in Italian, correct me if I'm wrong, means work or labour.
Mm-hmm. There's just more work, there's more distinctions in Italian than
what, could you English. Could you offer a translation, because you are a native speaker?
So operaio is the factory worker.
There we go, yeah.
But opera is both the labour and the great oeuvre.
Okay.
So there is no distinction between high and low in
for
that
sure.
sense.
But that's so fascinating, because one of the reasons I'm like vocal labour opera is because of that root of the word, meaning to do with the work, the production. Well, that's what they call it, an opera production. You've got the orchestra, you've got the chorus, you've got the people that build the props, you've got the people that the scenery. Like
that's the actual labour, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like it's on that scale, and then you get this kind of... this experience that involves like the visual elements, the sound elements, and the, you know, this sort of design and experience. So when considering making an art show, it's kind of like there's always going to be little elements of that, including, you know, you have this curtain which is printed with the kind of texture
vegetable dye.
With vegetable dye, which kind of, you know, it resonates and it is inspired by the way that the octopus shifts and changes its colour. And that curtain is on a timer, which is also connected to the light, which is connected to the music, which has all these objects. So it's kind of like, you know, there is... it's not just kind of like being like, oh yeah, opera. It's like all these elements make up this experience. And I guess it's like... a big shift from what we expect, which is like these red velvet seats and like a diva in there in a big dress. It's like these elements that, you know, are present in this form of artwork that gives like this affecting experience. So it's not too wild that we're talking about opera at all, I guess.
No.
Yeah.
Maybe to finish on this subject, there is a really beautiful letter between Mary McCarthy and Hannah Arendt. Mm. When Hannah Arendt was working on The Life of the Mind, there is a whole section on work, trying to understand the difference between work and labor. And I think Mary McCarthy is in Italy. Mm-hmm. And she goes through all the different words that exist in Italian to differentiate between different forms of work, labor, etc. You know, like in English, labor is also birth, the labor of birth. In Italian, there's travaglio. There's like all these other distinctions, and trying to understand why there would be a language with so many different ways of explaining work effectively. It's very beautiful. It's
what's also the name of the essay again?
It's a letter. It's a letter. One of their letters. I can send it to you.
What's it? What's the name of it, just for anyone else? Do you remember?
So there was a, I wish I remembered, but there was one book published of their letters. They wrote to each other for 25 years. So it's very much the story of their friendship. And they worked for each other as well, in the sense of each one helped the other one develop their work. Even though one was a novelist, Mary McCarthy was a novelist, and Hannah Arendt, a political theorist, or a philosopher, depending how you want to say it. And these 25 years of letter are condensed into a volume that was published maybe about 10 years ago. Very beautiful, sort of bringing these letters together from Hannah Arendt's archive, which is in Bard College in upstate New York, where she's buried, actually. Mm. It's like a lifetime of a friendship, no?
Beautiful. Any more questions?
I've almost forgot what I was going to say. But yeah, I just feel that people are like octopus in a sense. You know, we have a very high state, or some people have a very high state of awareness. You know, our brain is linked to thousands and thousands of nerves in our body. And going back to the music thing, it's a frequency thing, isn't it? You know, you can feel it. And I think some people, like musicians, I guess, are attuned, and they tune into that. They connect with that frequency, or those frequencies, and have an ability, if you like, to, you know, to be more sensitized to it. And then I think perhaps I do feel myself, I'm not a musician at all, but when I listen to certain tracks and music, it kind of takes over my body. It's not just a case of listening to music, but you feel the music, and I'm not sure whether listening to it or feeling it, you know, which one is gives you the greater sensory kind of feedback, if you like, and reaction. And does that feedback potentially give you that creativity? Does it, you know, does it spur you on? And does it give you that, you know, creativity? So what I'm saying is, it's not just a case of hearing the music, it's feeling it and being in the music itself and totally connected to it. Then it suddenly creates and causes some kind of a flow, you know, an awareness.
That's so spot on, and it's almost like I was in a roundabout way trying to get to that when I was playing the Arvo Pärt piece, where I was like, I know that I absorbed this. And I know it was because I learnt to conduct in six through conducting that. And I can still do it, and I can still remember two, three. I had to point at my friend who was playing the bell, because the bell comes on the fourth beat. And I had to point at her, because she's an untrained musician, and that's important, that the Peckham Chamber Orchestra involves people who are not trained as musicians, because that's also breaking down the hierarchies and stuff like that. But going through all those unritualized and ritualized moments of working with that piece, and now I absorbed it, not just, like you say, through my ears, through my body.
It is.
Yeah.
Through your nervous system, you know, and I think that stimulates your brain in turn, and it's a circular thing.
Absolutely.
You know, and it heightens your, you suddenly become different. It's almost like a drug.
You it know, is
so
a drug.
You just become, it is a drug, yeah. You become different, and it stimulates your brain, and so it goes on.
Yeah.
You know, because we all know our skin and our bodies have a degree of sensitivity, and that sensitivity will increase and change. Mm. You know, it goes back to the octopus. It, you know, we all, that is an incredible thing, how the octopus can change its skin, even though it's only got one eye, hasn't it? How can it see behind itself? How does it know what the environment actually looks like when it's actually behind it? Does it feel the environment? Does it actually map its environment out and remember what it looks like?
It thinks through its skin.
Exactly.
It also sees
but
through its skin.
This is exactly my point. It's not just an octopus that does that. We do that as well. You rest assured, that's what we do. I believe so anyway. You know, we are sensitive. We are sensitive to light. We are sensitive to heat. Many, many different things. Not just through our eyes and our ears, as we, you know, it's through our skin as well. We feel it. We can sense things. We know things are there when we can't even see them, for example. You know, we can feel things. And our nervous system is an extension of our brain. 100. It feeds back the information.
I guess the main difference is that we don't change our appearance based on experiencing that, whereas, you know, that's for me, that's like the real fascination. Thank you.
Thank you.
But yeah, I mean,
maybe it's time to stop.
Yeah,
now.
I don't know
I'm
how
aware
long
of
we've
time.
7:20.
How
maybe
you
like any more questions?
Any more questions?
Thank you for your contribution.
Urgent questions. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Okay. Oh.
I don't know. Anyone has any more questions, or shall we? Okay. Yeah, I mean, a round of applause again, because that was kind of like halfway, right? Like, thank you so much
thank you for your
contributions today and that conversation. And for those who want to trace back some of these gems that has been shared this evening, the recording will be available in the next few weeks. So do keep your eyes on our socials and our website. So thank you so much for joining us today. Again, one last round of applause for Céline. Yeah, thank you so much.